So we're gonna, in this clip, talk about what is money and sort of where money comes from. So in order to do that, we're gonna start by looking at the story that's most often told in economics textbooks and in economics classrooms. And that is sort of a hypothetical story that goes something like this. So imagine that you live in a time in a community before money existed, and you need to trade one thing for another. And so maybe I need a new pair of shoes. And so Phil has a pair of shoes that I want. In order to get those shoes, I need to find something that he wants. So maybe he wants a jacket that I have, and we're able to make an exchange, shoes for a jacket. So this is barter. The issue with barter is that it essentially requires what's called a double coincidence of wants. So Phil has to have something that I want, and I have to have something that Phil wants, and in the right numbers. So it's possible to negotiate this, but it also can be really inefficient when you try to scale this up. So it might work in a small community or amongst friends or a family, but once you try to scale this up to a bigger system, it becomes very hard to navigate all of that and almost impossible to manage. And so this is where money comes into play, the story goes, that essentially money came in as a more efficient way to do these types of exchanges. And in this story, money comes first, and then eventually comes banking and credit. So within this school of thought, the history of money is usually a history of coinage, and money starts as a commodity. So it's essentially gold, or it's salt, or something that has a value in and of itself. The issue with this story is, and David Graeber points this out in his book, Debt the First 5,000 Years, the issue with this story is that anthropologists have found almost no evidence that these imaginary barter communities ever actually existed. And so what does that mean? That essentially means that this sort of story that's told doesn't really come from any anthropological evidence about barter. So barter did happen and does happen at times, but it was always sort of more of a thing between strangers or between tribes that were meeting rather than, you know, something that was the main mode of economic activity. And we also find that actually elaborate credit systems were established long before coinage was invented. So we see elaborate credit systems in the Indus Valley, in Mesopotamia, in ancient China. So that really changes the story about banking and credit and money. So rather than money coming first and then banking and credit, actually credit came first and then money was introduced. So if these elaborate systems of credit predate the invention of money and coinage, can we really think of money as, you know, just a commodity? And the credit theorists and the credit theory of money say, no, money isn't necessarily a commodity, but it's really an accounting tool for measuring debts, the debt we owe to other people. So it's money is essentially a symbol that's passed around that's a promise to pay back a debt. And the value of this symbol comes from our trust in other people, our trust in our society and the people that we're living and working with, that this money will be paid back. And that's also partly a trust in the state, that the state is good on this value and that the state will be able to enforce these relationships. And so we see both. We see that money has in the past been a commodity, but this credit theory of money also is true. And so is it a commodity? Is money credit? And the answer is really that it's both. It sits on this really fine line between being a thing with a precise and measurable value, with a value in and of itself, and being something that's built around our relationships to other people and our relationships to the state. So the important thing I think this leads to is actually a bigger conversation about our, not only our money, but what that means for our economy. So both money and our economy are not things that are sort of separate and independent, but they are deeply embedded in our social and our political relationships and shouldn't necessarily be distinguished from those.